Anne-Maria, Judith.
Yes.
Welcome to this radio program here. You're now visiting Holland. Yesterday you gave a seminar in Amsterdam, and then in a few days, tomorrow you start 7 days.
Tomorrow I start a 7-day workshop up at Van Woude in Baden, psychology at the chakras, and we spend one full day deeply diving into each chakra.
Yeah. I think a lot of people know you about your books and so on, but maybe you can say something about yourself for the people who don't know you, and why you are so very interested in chakras.
Well, I started my journey really as a child, always wondering about why are we here, mm-hmm. and who are we, and what is spirit. So I was always thinking that. But in 1975, I started into yoga. And when I started into yoga, I also was reading a lot of metaphysical things, and I discovered the chakras. And when I read the word, a shot of energy went through my whole body, like I had, you know, I just knew I'd found my path. Just in that moment, I saw it all laid out, and it's been my life's work ever since.
Well, how did you do the study to that subject? You had a yoga teaching education?
Well, I studied yoga back then, and I started teaching yoga. I probably shouldn't have because I didn't really have the training, but, you know, they didn't have teacher training programs then in 1975.
No, everything
like
has to start
today.
New.
Yeah, so I just started teaching, and I decided to organize my classes along the chakras, and they became very popular. And so that made me want to research the chakras more. So I started reading some of the old Sanskrit texts, not in the translations. The Serpent Power by Arthur Avalon was, you know, the main translation of the old text. And looking into what they really said, and when I first came across the word chakras, what was written about it was that you have to repress your lower chakras in order to get to your higher chakras. And something in me said, no, that's not right. So when I began my research, that's not at all what they say, you know. They say that these are different states, and each one contains the other, but you don't give up one in order to get to another. You stand in it. You know, you develop that, and then you can go on to the next level.
You have a force to make a big fundament for in the chakras also.
Yes,
it's
exactly.
Very important. Yeah.
Yeah. It's like you wouldn't send a child to try to get them to 12th grade when they haven't learned to read and write. Mm-hmm. You know, but the reading and writing that they learn then takes them on to their advanced study. So in the same way with the chakras, we need to get grounded and really open up the flow of emotions and, you know, get that energy flowing, and then that can take us to the crown. But to me, the chakra system is a model for wholeness, not to get someplace. It's a model to say, can I address my life on each one of these levels and see which one is strong and which one is weak, and how can I bring my life into better balance?
Yeah. What I also hear is that people say, well, I have to have all my chakras wide open. Mm. Is that correct? Is that the correct thing?
Well, I think when we say open, we need to... That's too simple. Mm-hmm. As I have seen it, that some chakras I call deficient, and they're very closed up. And some of them are too open. And they're so open that everything gets in there. So I call that excessive. And so I would rather say we need our chakras to be balanced than just necessarily open. Some people need to open. Some people need to shut down a little.
Yeah. Okay, can you explain a little bit how a chakra looks like?
Well,
is that to do?
It depends on who you're looking at. You know, your chakras are going to look like yours and mine are going to look like mine. Yeah. So. You know, if I look with my psychic vision, and I used to do chakra readings, and if I look, what I see is images that represent the energy of that person. So I might look at a third chakra and see an image of a truck, you know, or a boat or something, and that would be a metaphor for what's going on in their third chakra. You can see, you know, little swirls of light and color if you look with those eyes, but mostly you're allowing images to form in connection to the energy that you feel, and then we're interpreting those images, much like we do in dreams.
Yeah, this is not a real aesthetic vision, but it's more abstract.
More abstract,
and
yes.
Intuitive,
yeah.
Association.
Yeah.
Okay. Yesterday you gave a very good presentation about not only the chakras, but that's maybe a lot of people already know something about that. There are lots of books about that, of course. Lots of books of yours, of course. But very interesting is, of course, how we use it and how we use our energy body.
That's right.
In relationships to others.
That's right. That's right. And you know, the chakras come from the yoga tradition. You know that because you were also a yoga teacher. And many people in the New Age sort of want to take them out of that and you know, just work with crystals or something. And I'm not saying it's not okay to work with crystals, but I'm just saying there's a deeper meaning to the chakras as a transformational system, as a system for how we evolve, and that we need to do sadhana, we need to do practice to keep the chakras open. And you know, one of the prime practices is yoga, is hatha yoga, and pranayama and meditation, and you know, all the aspects of yoga that the chakras were designed, you know, they came out of that tradition. So I like to see the system honored by keeping it connected with the yoga tradition. Yeah.
A few days ago I spoke to someone who is a member of the Free Catholic Church, and he says, well, maybe the seven sacraments have something to do with the chakraments, the seven chakras.
The seven chakraments. Isn't that a great idea? Yeah. Well, Carolyn Mace is an author that wrote a book comparing the seven sacraments of Christianity to the seven to the ten Sephiroth of the Hebrew Kabbalah and the chakra system. So she kind of did that work. I'm not very schooled in Catholic theology. I didn't agree with all her associations, but I can see where you could draw these lines. And, you know, the Bible says there were, you know, he had in his hand seven stars. There were the seven deadly sins. So many things in many cultures come in sevens.
Yeah, and also the chakras.
And also the chakras,
There are lots of, there are also, of course, the association with color.
Yes.
What's the influence of color, for example, if you wear orange t-shirts?
Well, yesterday if you wore orange is because you were celebrating Colin's victory in the soccer match. The colors, if we know on the visible spectrum that the colors are a vibration of light, and a vibration at different speeds, different frequencies. So red is the slowest vibration of the spectrum that we see, and violet is the fastest. So it is said that the lower chakras vibrate more slowly, and then they speed up as you go higher until it vibrates so fast it's just one singular point of consciousness. So if you take seven chakras vibrating from slow to fast and seven colors, then you have, well, first chakra correlates to red, second chakra correlates to orange, third chakra to yellow, fourth to green, fifth chakra to a bright blue, an indigo blue, and then a violet. So that's sort of like an association. But there is something to the rainbow that has a certain order. You know, the chakras sort of put everything in a cosmic order. And it's not so much that the chakra is that color. But, you know, maybe if you want to be more grounded, you choose to wear red. You know, maybe if you feel like your energy is low and you want more fire, you choose to wear yellow. If you want to be more peaceful, you wear green. So it's just more like an association. But when we do our chakra 7-day intensive, the workshop next week, then we do one chakra each day, as I said, and so everyone wears red the first day.
Okay, that's...
And everyone wears orange the second day. And so because we're in that chakra all day, we're also in the color. And people are told ahead of time, you know. But when I travel to Holland, it makes for a lot of luggage.
All those clothes.
To bring that many, that many clothes,
There are lots of theories, of course, about the chakra system. There are also theories about more than seven.
There are. And I get that question every time I give a talk. What about the other chakras? And here's my answer to that. And, of course, everybody has their own opinion. The ancient texts talk about seven major chakras, and some of them only talk about six. They do have in the esoteric literature some sub-chakras, like the heart chakra has a little sub-chakra called the Anandakanda lotus. And the upper chakras, you know, it's like the guru chakra and the soma chakra. So there's a little, there's a few subtler ones. But still there's seven major ones that map onto the nervous system, because we have seven big branches of ganglia coming out. You saw that slide last night of the nervous system. So that corresponds to what's in the body. Now, if you think of the chakras like a necklace of jewels, when you go and say there's a point up here, well, that's the end of the necklace. And a point down there. So that's like where you would fasten it, right? Mm-hmm. And then the chakras are the jewels that line up in here. I think of these as sort of a reference point, but not really a chakra. And you can't do much to influence that, you know? What's inside your body?
It's about the physical body energy centers,
And I have yet to see anyone, including myself, who has mastered all seven chakras.
No, so, it's a very big work to do for yourself.
And especially the people that are asking about the 13th chakra. I mean, they're the ones that have least mastered the first seven. So I say, let's get this down. I'm not denying that they exist, but, you know, it's a complex system, even with seven.
What can happen is also that you forget the basic chakras and already... busy with the highest chakras, and you are not good grounded anymore.
That's right. Yeah. That's right. So we need to really, you know, again, it's a system for wholeness, not a system for escape.
Yeah, that's what you can see, of course, and also in the spiritual world, that people try to escape from the basic things.
Yeah. I've had so many people, you know, after a talk come up to talk to me, and I'll be talking to someone and in a conversation. And they'll butt right into the conversation to tell me how enlightened they are and how they've opened their crown chakra. And I look at them and say, well, if you're so enlightened, why didn't you notice you were interrupting this conversation? Why didn't you notice you were being rude, you know? Uh-huh. So there's a lot of, can be a lot of ego, even in spirituality.
Yeah.
You know, look at me, I'm so, you know.
Yeah. But it happens. Shit happens everywhere, say.
It does.
Okay, let's go back to the global thing, because that was yesterday also your main speech. You have also wrote a book, Heart for the World, Heart for the World in Dutch. And we are now living in very interesting times. And it's a choice we have to make.
We are the first generation with this much choice over our lives, and it may feel to many people like they don't have a choice, but actually we have the tools of power at our hands. We have our computers, we have our cell phones, we have our cars if we have one, we can get on an airplane, we can pick up the telephone. So we have tools to take action, and this is a time in the world where it's about the empowerment of the people. But the empowerment not of individuals so much as people working together and lifting the whole organizing principle from the third chakra up to the fourth chakra.
Yeah. But how do we do that? Because lots of people in the world are not busy with chakras or something like that.
Well, you don't even have to know about chakras. You could talk about all this with never using the word chakra. And really, the way I put it is that we are moving from an organizing principle based on the love of power to the power of love. And so you can say it that way, and you don't even have to use the word chakra. But people understand, oh yes, there is a love of power. We worship heroes. We worship people that have money. You know, we have elevated war heroes. We're actually elevating people that kill. You know, we elevate the rich. We are elevating people that exploit and take from others, you know. Politicians and, you know, people of authority, that's that love of power. But what we're finding is everybody has power. Now that we have the tools to collaborate and cooperate with each other, we can create a greater power in our numbers than any single person can have. So that's the power of love, the power of joining together.
Yeah, and now we're living in time with things are coming more in the open, in the publicity. Yeah?
Yes.
Things have went wrong and frauds and so on. So there are lots of changes in this world going on.
Oh, many changes. It's amazing.
And the system is collapsing.
And the system is collapsing. But what's collapsing is the old system.
Yeah.
And if you look, people are building a new system all over the place. And as the old system collapses, the new system is growing. And we hope that the new system is ready to go by the time the old system really collapses. And I think we're very close to the time where the new system gains the majority. You know, it just passes over critical mass. Right now it's not at, you know, at 50% yet, but I think it's moving and growing so fast that it's going to be over 50%. Although Paul Hawken, as I mentioned last mm-hmm. night, says the largest movement on the planet today, the greatest number of people, it's no one movement that you can count this many people, is people volunteering their time and their energy and their money to create non-governmental organizations, NGOs, mm-hmm. to address environmental sustainability, social justice, peace, democracy, the study of consciousness, economic well-being, green energy, you know, all of those things. That's all part of this new paradigm. And people are, you know, changing to that. They're supporting it. They're giving their service to it.
Yeah. And do you think also the money system will last?
No, I don't think this money system will last. I think it's broken. I think it's corrupt. And I think that it is based on a scarcity model because it's based on the idea that everyone is supposed to go out and get as much as they can for themselves and their family. And so when you do that, you try to take as much, you create scarcity in the commons. If you have a model that everybody gives, like we were just talking about a potluck dinner where everybody brings food. Mm. Every potluck I've been to has had more food than people could eat.
Yeah.
You know, there's been an abundance. So when you have the model that the idea is to give money, mm-hmm. then there's abundance for everybody. Now, what will we see in our lifetimes? Will we see the disappearance of the dollar? You know, I don't think so. But what we are seeing is pockets where money doesn't even come into the picture. For instance, software engineers donating their time for free to create an operating system called Linux that also they knew in donating their time they would never sell. So they're donating it knowing they'll never get anything in money back. So there's many places, and you know, these non-governmental organizations, people are giving their time for free. You know, they're volunteering on weekends to go out and, you know, petition the streets or to serve the poor or to raise money for the cause. They're not getting paid for that. So what we see is pockets where people are operating outside of the monetary system. Every new paradigm starts in little pockets. You know, that's the imaginal cells. So as these pockets grow bigger and bigger, then the old money system starts to lose its force and the new money system starts to grow. A friend of mine, Hazel Henderson, who works in economics, says, you know, there's trillions of dollars that people have put into socially responsible investment, right? So that's a big budget that people say, no, I don't want to invest in a company that is exploiting people or logging the rainforest. I want to invest in a company that's doing green energy. I want to invest in a company that is, you know, serving the common good. And we vote with our dollars, yeah. or our euros. We vote with our euros.
Yeah. Okay, this is still, of course, going on. There are lots of initiatives global-wide mm-hmm. about this. Last week I interviewed the man behind the Venus Project. Mm-hmm. If you know, heard something about it, that's a project about a new society with no money and lots of new architecture and everybody.
Oh yes, I have seen that guy interviewed. Yeah, yeah. Now it rings a bell.
And this man is 94.
Yeah, he was in the Zeitgeist film, right?
Yeah.
I saw that.
All this sort, that kind of initiatives are going on still,
yes.
of course. Yeah.
Yes.
Another thing you mentioned yesterday was the time we live in, and if you compare it with the chakras,
mm-hmm.
the basic chakra was in a time that we have to struggle for life.
That's right. The first chakra represents the instinct to survive. It's our survival mm-hmm. consciousness. So if we look at humanity, mm-hmm. with this idea, then this was the infancy of humanity, where we were born out of nature, and our first task was to survive. So most of the time was spent hunting and gathering and living very close to the earth and in very small tribes. And the average lifespan was about 30 years old then. You know, if you lived to be 40, you were an old man. So that was our first chakra. That was the Paleolithic, you know. And then when we learned to plant seeds and begin farming, that was the second chakra. Second chakra is the element water. So this was irrigation and the control of water for growing food, and also simultaneously the beginning of building ships that could sail across the water and trade. And then you could trade with other tribes who had other languages, other customs, and humanity began to evolve. And also when we could farm, we could stay in one place. So then we could grow. Then as we learned how to feed everybody and population was just expanding exponentially, you know, women had 10 kids and in two generations there were 100, you know, that was really going very fast. There were so many people that didn't know what to do. They had enough food. That wasn't the problem. The problem was organization. How do you organize that many people? I mean, they had cities of 50,000 people with no newspapers, no cars, no telephones. No one could read or write. You know, they were just beginning to create writing. And so how do you coordinate that many people in a small space? That's a real challenge for a younger mentality. So it seems logical to me that some people who would feel a sense of power would say, well, I know what to do, and I'm going to tell all of you what to do, right? So the kings rose, the kings and the priests, and they were the ones that were said to be connected to God, and so people worshipped them and did what they were told. And so we were a society of masters and slaves, and we built the pyramids, and we built the first civilizations, and we continued to grow. We had specialization of labor because we had enough food to feed everybody, but we were running out of land and water, and so when we ran out of land and water, we went into fights, little fights, right? Little skirmishes between tribes. And the way I see it is a tribe only needed to get wiped out once to say, well, next time we're going to be ready. So let's spend our time making spears and weapons, and let's train our boys how to fight so that next time we're ready. And in fact, we have to go practice, right? And what then begins is the escalation of war that has been going on ever since, to the point where now we have escalated into nuclear weapons. So this has all been the third chakra era of aggression and domination and power over. You know, seeing an authority who rules the masses and tells them what to do, and everyone obeys. In fact, I call it not the dominant paradigm, but the submissive paradigm, because there's more people submitting than there are dominating. So we're still living in this, but we're at a place where that's changing. This was 5,000 years from the beginning of writing in the first civilizations to now. Not only, you know, was it used for power and aggression and domination, but that power was used for good things. It was used for getting more food to more people. It was used for raising the standard of living. It was used for disseminating knowledge, building schools, studying medicine, science, you know, all the things that have allowed us to mature as a species to a more sophisticated level of understanding. 5,000 years ago, you know, we didn't know what we knew now. We didn't know about the world. We didn't have the technology. So we are more mature now as a culture than we were then, right? And yet we have these leftovers from that time, that the way to solve problems is to go to war, you know, that the way to make money is to exploit other people, that the way to get something done is to get other people to do it. You know, so we still have these holdovers, and that if we just put the right person on top, everything will be fine, right? But we even see in the States right now, having elected Obama, who we thought was a pretty good guy, he can't get anything done because nobody will let him. You know, the Congress is just fighting back and forth, and the system is broken. And I think what we're seeing from authority is disappointment everywhere. You know, Copenhagen, we had hopes that would be something that would really make a difference, and nothing happened. You know, the G20 just met, and everyone was disappointed. Nothing happened, you know. That the change is not going to come from that sector of society. the change is going to come from all these people in the NGOs taking care of what the governments are not taking care of. They're taking care of the earth. They're taking care of the economy. They're taking care of peace. They're dealing with these issues. The government is failing to keep the economy in check. It's failing to keep the peace. It's failing to take care of the environment.
Yeah, it is awful. Mostly, for example, if I had a household book like our country or the United States, I would be somebody who lives on the street.
If you had a house, yeah.
Yeah, and that's...
That's right, that's right. The people who are losing their houses, and it's really corrupt. It's really corrupt. It's predatory lending that, you know, let's make you a loan that you can't afford, so then after you come up with the money, we'll take your house away.
Yeah. But there's hope.
There's a lot
Lots of hope.
Yes, there is.
And if you don't have it, then that's a pity, but there is hope. Because you said we all are leaders now.
We are all leaders.
And we have to stand up for our leadership.
That's right. We have to stand up and become our own authority.
Mm-hmm.
So we used to see outer authority as the source.
And
the inner authority
is our
resource.
Problems. Yeah, and we can solve our problems ourselves.
Yes, and not alone, but with
together.
Each other.
Yeah.
You know, and even if, you know, let's say you have a medical problem. Well, you can look it up on the internet. You don't have to take your doctor's advice just like that. You can say, okay, well, that's one opinion. I'm going to research on the internet what other medicines work for this. What are some natural medicines? What are some alternatives to surgery? You want to research with a business? You don't have to take their word for it. You can do research. You can find out anything you want.
Yeah, and that's a new bit. But also, of course... A little critical point, of course, the people in Bangladesh don't do that.
No, they don't. And there's many people that are in horrible poverty. About one-fifth of the population of the planet is in absolutely horrible conditions. They don't have access even to clean drinking water. There are at least 50 million homeless refugees just walking around, homeless because of environment, homeless because of war. I mean, 50 million people. Without much to eat, living in tents and living in horrible conditions. So, you know, we can't ignore that. We have a long way to go.
Because we are connected with each other, so that's also what we...
That's right. We are all connected. Yeah. And you can see that what's arising in the population is a kind of compassion that didn't used to be there.
Mm-hmm.
For instance, when the earthquake happened in Haiti,
yeah.
There was an immense outpouring of... money from people donating $5 here and $10 there and, you know, going to Haiti to help. Again, it wasn't coming from the government.
No, it was all the people themselves.
Yes. Yeah. Citizens are going down to the Gulf of Mexico to help clean up the oil. The government's not doing a good job of cleaning it up, you know. So, again, it's the people making it happen. And it's only going to happen when the people demand it. And the people who are living in terrible poverty... They don't even have the means to demand anything. They're in survival. They're still in first chakra consciousness, you know. And we need a system that actually helps to lift people out of that poverty. You know, what they're finding is that educating women makes them have less babies. You know, so part of what keeps the poverty going is they have so many children because the women don't know how to get birth control. But when they actually educate the women and give them birth control, they want to have 2 children instead of 6. And if they have 2 children instead of 6, they don't have as much poverty, right? It doesn't cost as much to feed. And so by controlling population and educating the women, we gradually lift these cultures up out of poverty.
Yeah, because you said yesterday also something about the male energy and the female energy.
Mm-hmm.
And of course we lift... thousands of years in the patriarchal society.
Yes, we do.
And things also are now also shifting
they
that
are.
Way.
And, you know, the patriarchal society has been going on as long as this third chakra period. It was really that overthrow of... that was the first domination, the domination of the goddess cultures. And, you know, so... I have a saying, you know, men have a thing and women have a place, right? But men have created many things in this world. We have stereos and bicycles and cars and airplanes and computers and tape recorders. We have many things, but we have trashed the place. So now we need to put the feminine emphasis on the place, the environment, the earth, the spaces that we have, keeping it clean, you know, like paying attention to what the outcome is of something, and that we don't need so many things. We're cluttered with too many things, you know. So that's part of the balance. It's not even so much the liberation of women, which is important, but it's the liberation of female values, the values of community, of nurturing,
and
of
holding
love.
Things together.
That's and holding quality things together, yeah. Pulling them into a wholeness. And even the value of emptiness. You know, the yin is empty and still. We don't need something all the time. We need more quiet. We need more free time. We need more emptiness, you know, to balance out this yang culture that is doing and creating and going all the time. And we're all getting tired from that.
From mindfulness to mind emptiness.
Yeah, that's very nice. Mindfulness to mind emptiness. I like that.
Yeah. Yesterday you also, that's very nice about the movie Avatar. It's a metaphor of how it could be here.
Yes, that's right. Yeah. That's right. It's a metaphor of a culture that really does value nature and sees consciousness in nature. The trouble is, most people now, more than 50% of the world, live in cities. And we just crossed that line, you know. It used to be 30%, and you know, but more and more people live in cities. And they actually spend 90 or 100% of their time away from nature. Yeah. You know, they might have some plants, and there might be a tree
on the balcony,
outside.
Some tomatoes.
They have some plants on the balcony. But, you know, they go and walk on the street, and they get in the trolley and, you know, or the train, and their feet don't touch real ground. And they don't know what it's like when nature is in its original connection with many trees and the ground and the birds and hasn't been spoiled yet. So I think part of the change is that our nervous systems were built for nature, not for this world. And that every so often we need to go to nature, go out to the wilderness for a day or two, enough to get this out of your consciousness. And it resets your, it sort of resets the dials, you know. It resets your nervous system. Our eyes were not designed to look at a computer all day. They were designed to look across the way and be able to recognize that bird coming down from the sky. Our bodies weren't designed to sit at a desk and hold still all day. Our bodies were designed to dig in the dirt and climb trees and walk and run. So we need to get back to that, to get back to our wholeness.
Yeah, and that's you also see, of course, that now children don't know how a cow looks like,
that's
something
right.
like that. Yeah. The meat is coming from the supermarket, not
that's
from
right.
cows.
Yeah,
or the
eggs
food.
Or something that come in a package.
Yeah.
You have nothing to do with the chicken. Yeah, yeah.
Yeah, but then we have to go make also another kind of system about cities, villages, and so on, because.
That's right. Because people do live in cities, and there's an advantage to living in cities as well. There's all this culture, and actually people evolve more quickly in cities because they're
more contact.
More contact with more difference. And you know, the more people you interact with, the more feedback you have and the faster you evolve. So that's why sometimes out in the country people can seem a little more backward. So we need to bring more nature into our cities. You know, we need to have more flowers and more parks and, you know, more. And there is a movement towards that. There's a movement towards natural food.
Yeah.
There's a movement towards getting our bodies back and being fit, doing yoga or working out and, you know, or dance and, you know, many of these things that to say, yes, come back to the body, paying attention to what we eat, paying attention to what we wear. Is it natural fiber, you know? The things that we buy, are they organic? You know, so there's a movement to go back to that. It's slow, but it's happening.
And also when all collapse, then we have to go to nature to
That's
find
right.
our food. But
That's
the supermarkets
right.
will be empty then.
Yes. You know, I don't know about in Europe, but in America, it's terrible. The average grocery item in the supermarket travels 1,500 miles. What's that? It's like 2,500 kilometers, you know, to get there. And there are towns now called transition towns.
Transition towns, yes.
That are saying, no, you know, we want to have a town that doesn't depend on oil. We're going to grow our own food. And neighbors who, you know, live on a block, they can rip up the fences and combine their yards and say, let's make a community garden here.
Yeah.
Because then we can get our food directly, not have to drive, not have to use oil to get it.
You already said yesterday from ecosystem.
Yeah. Yes, and from greed to green.
Yeah.
Yeah. So we need to coin these words that help articulate this change so people can understand what it is we're doing.
Yeah.
Yeah. It also happens on the individual level that we need to move beyond an ego-based consciousness that is oriented to, you know, how can I get mine, to a more community-based consciousness. And to really collaborate and be in community, you got to drop your ego sometimes. You got to learn to surrender. You have to go into the yin, the feminine, a little bit. A true community, you know, doesn't have one person that's more important than another. Everyone's important. You know, but sometimes that takes a loss of ego for the people who think they're important.
But that's, of course, that people want to have some stimulants for what they do that people think that's good, that they do that good.
Right, they want
so and if everyone believes that he or she is already perfect as she is or he is, then you can let the ego go.
Yes, that's right. And you don't need to be affirmed by other people. But, you know, it is natural that people want to be recognized for their contribution. There's nothing wrong with that.
I see you.
I see you. Yeah, I see your talent. Oh, that's wonderful. You know, when we get that appreciation, then, you know, we glow with it.
Yeah.
I have a saying, what we appreciate appreciates. It increases in value when we appreciate something. So that's important, but it's, you know, we need to sometimes turn loose of our own agenda, that there may be a deeper agenda trying to come about.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay. Maybe it's good also to say something about your latest publication here in Holland. It's the a DVD with the artwork of Wim, Wim Zero.
Will Zero, yes.
Will Zero. Can you tell something about it?
Yes, the DVD I created, the actual DVD I created with my son, and it's a 30-minute journey through the chakras of animated art that takes you through the chakras with a voiceover.
Mm-hmm.
And then I started putting it into other languages, and then we put it into Dutch, and I met Will Zero at the first Rishi's event and really liked his artwork. And so when we came to put a booklet, we said, well, let's make a picture booklet to go with the DVD. So the picture booklet features Will's art.
Okay.
And the presentation that I did last night had a lot of Will's art in it as well.
Okay.
And so we're talking about working on some other projects.
Okay. Do you believe in 2012?
Well, here's what I believe about 2012. It's a little hard without a visual to go with it. But that different paradigms have risen and fallen since the beginning of time. So the first chakra paradigm rose up, and when it reached its height, that's when we started the second chakra paradigm. And that, you can imagine that growing as the other one falls. There's a point where they cross.
Mm-hmm.
And then the third chakra paradigm reached its height. I think the height of the third chakra paradigm was around World War II, and then World War II was such an awful thing that that began the decline. And it already started to decline. At that time, the peace movement, the hippie movement, came up
already,
right after that. So that was the start of the next one. So this is, you know, this fourth chakra paradigm has been growing for some time. The third chakra paradigm has been declining. And I see 2012 as the point where they cross. So if you see a graph of one going down and one going up, that it's not like some huge earth-shaking thing. But you just notice that what has been on the fringe is now mainstream.
Yeah.
And what's on the mainstream is now, you know, going away. It's dying. People are jumping ship onto the new one. And exactly when that'll happen,
it's,
and, you know,
it's just a time frame, but not a...
That's right. Yeah. And the time frame includes what's happening now, and it includes what's happening after 2012. You know, the Gulf crisis is part of this turning. You know, it's a catastrophe that is making people invest in clean energy instead of oil, you know? So there will be many things between now and 2012. And that's probably a point where things get as bad as they're going to get, and then they start to get better.
After every crisis, there's a new begin.
A new beginning, yeah. And every crisis is also an opportunity.
Opportunity.
Yeah, yeah. So I look at these crises as evolutionary drivers, that they are driving evolution through their negativity. Even, you know, George Bush, because everybody hated him so much, they organized and created so many counterculture.
He did a lot of good work.
And he actually, because he was so negative, he did a lot of good work. You know, because, you know, my son said to me, you know, well, George Bush turned us into a generation that cared.
Yeah.
He says, I would have just gone to sleep otherwise.
Yeah.
You know, so even our negativity does some good in a strange way.
Okay. Anodeya, thank you very much for this conversation.
Thank you so much.
It's and lots of success with the 7 days in Van Woude. Thank
you. Thank you. And I hope people pick up Hartford Wereld and learn more about our history and how we came to be where we are and where we're going.